time when miners strapped on 12-foot-long hickory skis and navigated avalanche-prone canyons, to a half-billion-dollar tourism industry supported by 14 resorts, skiing in Utah spans more than a century. Salt Lake City's 2002 Winter Olympic Games are a product of that history. Wasatch Range, a western arm of the Rocky Mountains, is Utah's skiing hub. It's a 250-mile-long fold rising 12,000 feet above sea level. Geographically, the range is ideally located to block quickly moving storms, forcing them to drop light, deep snow in short periods of time, as much as 800 inches in some seasons. A quart bottle filled with this powder can melt down to just a swallow of water. Other ranges may get more snow, but few can claim the quality and dependability of Wasatch powder. Scandinavian linemen, mail carriers, and miners were the first to ski these mountains. Groups like the Wasatch Mountain Club organized some of the first ski outings in the early 1900s. A popular trip was an overnight tour from the mining town of Park City to Brighton. With modern gear based on old forms, today's backcountry skiers follow many of those same routes. People quickly became hooked on the sport. Other clubs put together ski trains to Park City and Ogden in the 1930s. These early ski outings paled in comparison to the thrilling displays of grace under pressure at Ecker Hill in Parley's Canyon. Ecker Hill was the site of several jumping tournaments, such as the 1937 National American Ski Championships. In front of thousands, the best of that era flew here. Engen, Rude, Fredbo, and Ulin were fierce competitors who commonly traded world record titles, sometimes on the same day. Sigmund Rude describes riding the wind. The sensation lasts only a few seconds, but it feels like an eternity. With a powerful, self-actuated stance, the jumper glides into space, entirely free and unhindered. Rude's childhood friend and strongest competitor was a young Norwegian nicknamed the Human Airplane. Alf Engen emigrated from Norway in 1929. He may have been the greatest all-round skier that ever lived. Engen captured 16 national titles and set a number of jumping records. In 1940 and 41, he won national titles in all four disciplines: ski jumping, cross country, downhill, and slalom. This feat has never been accomplished since.
Ecker Hill was special for me because I already knew that we had tremendous snow. And I already knew that the hill was big and we could make it bigger and bigger. We were professionals and we were set up so that whenever we went into the hill, if we could set a new world record, we got an extra payday. So we wanted to have a hill where we could break the world record.
Engen had many accomplishments. He designed and built more than 30 ski resorts, including Utah's Alta, Bryan Head, Brighton, and Snow Basin. He pioneered equipment and skiing techniques, but his greatest passion was teaching. His legacy is the 250,000 graduates of the Deseret News Ski School he helped to launch in 1948.
Oh yes, and it's fun watching Alf teach the youngsters. He has a special gift for that. In a few short lessons, he has them skiing so beautifully that their ability often becomes a source of embarrassment to their parents.
Alf Engen died in 1997 at the age of 88.
Well, Alf Engen, in my opinion, was the epitome of what skiing stood for. His skiing ability was unique, I mean, unmatched by anybody. And his personality, of course, was expressed all the time with his smile, his outgoingness, and his happiness. And I think we lost a very, very important part of skiing when we lost Alf Engen.
Nordic jumping continues a few miles from Ecker Hill at the Utah Winter Sports Park. Modern competitors use the more aerodynamic V-style that allows them to exceed distances of 600 feet, twice that of the jumpers of Engen's day. Those who were fortunate to be at Ecker Hill witnessed ordinary men do extraordinary things. It was an era brimming with the discovery of a new American winter pastime, and many of those spectators wanted to try skiing for themselves. Alta Ski Area owes its beginnings to George Watson, a miner intrigued by this new sport. He sold 1,800 acres to the Forest Service for $1. On Sunday, January 15th, 1939, the Collins chairlift sputtered to life, the second in the country. An all-day lift ticket cost $1.50. A group of Salt Lake City businessmen, led by attorney Joe Quinney, provided the capital and were the business savvy behind Alta. They never intended to build a destination ski resort, but rather a modest area for locals. Despite this, Alta's mystique quickly spread, attracting skiers from around the world. Legendary broadcaster Lowell Thomas skied Alta four or five times each season. In 1944, to promote Alta, 20th Century Fox produced a classic film in state-of-the-art Technicolor.
But to those three wingless wonders, this is paradise. Who are they? They are the Engen brothers, three Norwegian Americans whose skill on skis is known throughout the world of winter sport. Want to meet them? Why not? Here's Alf, former Olympic star and national combined and four-way champion. Sverre, second of the trio, also a skier of great renown. Kara, the youngest, who follows the Engen tradition in perfect stride. The three Engens afford our color camera a rare study in the fine art of carving figure eights. Sverre does the schuss, or straight run. Alf and Kara negotiate the curves. The professor makes with appropriate music.
By the early 1940s, alpine skiing was established coast to coast. The number of skiers was small but rapidly growing. That growth would temporarily succumb to a much larger issue. Alta wasn't immune from the global turmoil of World War II. A month after the attack on Pearl Harbor, 150 soldiers from Company B, 503rd Parachute Battalion, arrived in Alta to train under head instructor and Olympic ski team member Dick Durrance.
In Utah, they alight on the frosty earth at Alta, and sometimes it's lucky there's a soft cushion of snow to land in. The sky and ski troops, having landed, continue their advance in the way made famous by winter warfare. It's all a part of new army training for every kind of battle, combining parachute tactics with winter campaigning. Warfare of air plus snow.
Only about a third of Durrance's troops became proficient on skis. It hardly mattered. Eventually, the 503rd was separated, and the bulk of the troops went to snowless North Africa for the American invasion of Italy. Although Alta's chairlifts no longer grind to a halt at lunch as they once did, the place seems almost relentless in its determination to honor Joe Quinney's original dream to not make skiing exclusively a rich man's sport. At the top of Big Cottonwood Canyon, Brighton Ski Resort followed Alta, opening in 1939.
This double chairlift will take us up hundreds of feet to the top. And on the way, we can see one of the reasons why skiing is fast becoming America's most loved sport.
40 minutes from Salt Lake City on the backside of the Wasatch Front is Park City, Utah's only true claim to a resort town. It's an eclectic mix of about 7,500 diehard skiers, big city refugees, and working professionals. Add to that the tens of thousands of visitors who come every winter to the slopes of the canyons, Deer Valley Resort, and Park City Mountain Resort. Organized skiing in the Park City area dates back to the 1920s, when the town's future was described as a mecca for winter sports.
Here there's a variety of perfect ski runs for every level of ability.
Annually, these resorts tally over a million skier days, numbers probably light years beyond the dreams of the original developers. Mel Fletcher is a third-generation Parkite and an early skiing supporter. In 1946, he wrote, "I want to congratulate two ski lovers and sportsmen who have the fortitude and ambition to tangle with weather and many obstacles in an effort to bring the community a ski lift." Mel was speaking of Otto Carpenter, who actually was a carpenter, and Bob Burns, who worked in Park City's silver mines. In 1946, the pair fired up their Ford truck motor that powered the T-bar they had designed and built. They called the area Snow Park, now Deer Valley.
Deer Valley is a class act. It's not snobbish, but it is put on the level that we feel that the skiers deserve. For the amount of money that they pay today to go skiing, they need the ultimate experience, and we give it.
Tom McIntosh, Deer Valley's lead groomer.
Very nice to come out here to Deer Valley and ride first chair, and it just blows your mind. I mean, there's just acres and acres of seamless corduroy. Now it looks like we just rolled out fresh carpet on every run. It's kind of what the public wants, so that's what we give them.
Stein Eriksen came to Deer Valley after 8 years at Park City ski area.
Top man at Park City is the incomparable Stein Eriksen. 1952 Olympic champion, 1954 world champion, and now director of skiing at Park City.
One of the greatest thrills I get out of skiing is when I ski the powder snow. Powder snow gives me the feel of soaring. It gives me the feel of kind of floating through a cloud almost. This must be the climax of satisfaction when it comes to skiing.
I think that I have developed the reputation of having unique and graceful style. In any profession that you are in, you want to accomplish the very best that you can. And that's what I'm trying to do in skiing. I want to present the sport in the most graceful and beautiful way possible to inspire other people to take up the sport.
Within the span of a century, Park City has swayed from silver mining riches to ghost town status to a prosperous world-class resort. It's a town struggling to preserve its historic roots under the pressures of growth.
Nothing, as I said, will ever be the same as time goes by. We are going to grow, we are going to be big, but we have people here in the core of controlling the town and the operation here that I'm very optimistic that we're going to keep a lot of the uniqueness.
The Wasatch Cache National Forest is on the fringe of a growing urban population, making it one of the five most visited national forests in the United States.
That was close.
Okay, my name is Roland Hurlbut, and I'm a volunteer with the Wasatch Cache National Forest. And one of the prime purposes of the Wasatch Cache National Forest is to provide recreation for people. And in order to do that, they've entered into a partnership with the Solitude Ski Resort under a 40-year agreement where they pay a percentage of their gross income to the federal government.
In addition to Solitude, Alta, Brian Head, Brighton, Snow Basin, and Snowbird operate on Forest Service land. As the agency extends itself into the business of winter recreation, balancing environmental protection and resort development becomes complex. User conflicts and regulations now seem to be a regular part of life.
This is one of the primary reasons the Forest Service was established up here, to protect the culinary water supply for the valley. Without this, there would be no Salt Lake City.
Utah ski historian and author Alexis Kelner is one of the founders of the organization Save Our Canyons. He was also instrumental in establishing the 25-square-mile Lone Peak Wilderness Area in 1977.
So far, the Forest Service, quote, partnerships arrangement with the ski industry has really benefited mostly the ski industry. I don't think it has benefited the general public as well. Because the public relies on watershed values other than just skiing, and the Forest Service is supposed to be managing the public lands for the public good, not necessarily for the ski industry good.
As the valley's been growing, it's very obvious there's much more people using the backcountry and recreation, and we're very slowly, especially as a backcountry skier, which is all I do, is we're getting squeezed out. There's been a lot of, especially now with the Olympics coming, there's a very pro-development push here.
Ted Johnson was a self-motivated ski bum with dreams of a new resort in the Peruvian Gulch Gad Valley area, a mile down canyon from Alta. In the mid-1960s, he began acquiring private land of prime skiing terrain. Johnson struggled for years to find the capital to launch Snowbird until he met Dick Bass, the son of a wealthy Texas oil and gas businessman. Bass is a self-described hyper-enthusiast who loves to talk, especially about skiing and Snowbird. He's also the first person to climb the highest peak on each of the seven continents.
I found out that he had this ski area project in his hip pocket, and the next day, the people that Ted was staying with showed this 13-minute homegrown movie he'd made about Snowbird. 13 minutes long, and it changed my life. I showed it around for a week or two, week and a half, and I couldn't get anyone to want to get involved, so I called him. I said, Ted, no one really wants to stick their neck out that much, but I've gotten all pumped up from seeing this movie so many times and telling people about it and everything, and what would you think if maybe I tried to get with you and we try to build this thing? I guess the best way to term it is he was the founder and I became the funder. And we started building that spring of 70.
In December 1971, the tram opened to the public. A Salt Lake Tribune article stated, the facilities are first class, and as a result, skiers should be expected to pay first class prices. A lift pass will cost $7.
I was always looking for a place that combined powdered snow and the sunshine, a place where people would like to be. The tram building and the aerial tramway and the chairlift is the highest quality resort facility in the United States.
The coming of Snowbird ushered in an entirely new era of commercialization of the canyons. With Snowbird came bigness, whereas before you had mom and pop type ski resorts, now all of a sudden you had lodges that at one time were two stories at most. Now you had 8-story, 10-story condominiums. That brought a lot of environmental consciousness into the community, and we still have it today.
In the early 1970s, the baby boomers infused a new spirit into the sport. Nationally, the number of ski resorts peaked. Utah promoters caught the publicity wave, and ski filmmaker Dick Barrymore captured that generation with his camera. The music, the styles, and hair. Although Brian Head and Elk Meadows both have a southern Utah address, they cater mostly to California and Nevada skiers. At 9,600 feet, Brian Head has Utah's highest base elevation and runs laid out by Alf Engen.
I think it's a great place to be.
These resorts are run by dedicated people like Brian Head Operations Manager Jeff Hunter. Hunter is a third-generation employee at Utah's southernmost resort. His grandfather, Mel, helped to install the area's first chairlift in 1964. North of Brian Head and the Tushar mountain range is Elk Meadows. It's a tucked away modern resort that averages about 35,000 skier days annually, compared to over 1 million for the three Park City resorts. Beneath Mount Tippinogus is Robert Redford's Sundance. The actor acquired the resort in 1968. North of Salt Lake City are four other resorts. Near Logan, Dr. Alvin Kobabe runs Powder Mountain. Snow Basin radiates below Ogden Peak. This understated mountain is rapidly joining the ranks of other posh destination resorts by hosting the Olympics. Nordic Valley began operating in the late 1960s. On a good day, it has Utah's most inexpensive lift ticket. Beaver Mountain is located in Logan Canyon.
My name's Ted Seeholzer. I'm owner and general manager of Beaver Mountain Ski Area. I've been here for, started working here when I was 12 years old, and I'm now 60 plus. I can certainly draw Medicare, I'll promise you that. But I've been involved here since Dad and Mother started it in the early 30s.
Beaver Mountain is a welcome step back in time, finally getting phone service in 1997. In an age of corporate consolidations, it has the distinction of being the country's longest family-owned and operated ski resort. Ted's parents mortgaged their home and saved $30,000 to install the first chairlift in 1960. Ted and his wife Margie and their family put in long days taking care of the steady local following.
How much longer, Ned?
About 10 or 15.
10 or 15?
Yeah.
Sons Corey and Travis are lift operators. Along with son-in-law Jeff West, they prepare for the day when it's their responsibility to continue the family tradition.
You know, this being a family resort and raising your family here is probably a very special thing in that it keeps you close. The boys and the daughters learn responsibility. They find out what it is to get up at 4 in the morning and work 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 at night, depending on what needs done. This resort right now would be difficult to operate without them.
What's your base this year?
Right now, I think we're looking at about 87. We've been up to 120, 122, something like that.
A number of smaller areas flourished and faded away because of poor timing, location, and finances. Little Mountain, Gorgoza, Rasmussen's Ranch, and Blue Mountain near Monticello in southeastern Utah were never meant to compete with destination resorts, catering instead to local communities. Blue Mountain Ski Area opened in 1959. A six-cylinder butane-powered motor ran the 900 vertical foot Pama till the early 1980s. Mechanic Earl Schaefer donated hundreds of hours to the area.
In the early 80s, they called me up to come up and help start it one time. It hadn't been running for two or three years, you know. And so I built these tools. This is a little slide right here. And when they got a dent or something in it, I had this like a slide hammer, and I'd go through the center, and when they were bent, I would heat the pipe. My kids would heat the pipe, and then I could straighten out a piece of pipe. So most of the tools I built, because it's all volunteer, and we could not afford everything, you know.
Local businessman Grant Bronson loaned $27,000 interest-free to install the Pommelift.
Everybody did all the work without any pay, and everything was donated here, and everybody felt like they were a part of it, and had a lot of good times here on this hill.
Blue Mountain's fate was high insurance cost and poor snow conditions. The crowds of skiers that came here on snowy weekends are now just a memory.
When I was looking up that thing, standing here, I think I got tears in my eyes right then, you know, because it hurt you when you grew up with something most of your life, you know. One of those things, you know.
Hello, everybody.
This is Lowell Thomas with the latest information on a thrilling subject. Snow avalanches may occur wherever snow is deposited on steep mountainsides. And when buildings, highways, ski resorts, and so on are in the mountains, then the avalanche hazard can be a real problem.
The destructive power of avalanches has plagued Alta residents since the late 1800s. So before recreational skiing could safely expand in the Cottonwood Canyons, there had to be a better understanding of this natural phenomena. Due to the work of pioneering snow scientists such as Dr. Edward LaChapelle, the threat of avalanches has dramatically decreased. LaChapelle was Alta's snow ranger from 1953 to 1971.
Yeah, the original reason for setting up all of this avalanche forecasting and control program in Little Cottonwood Canyon was driven by the fact that the Forest Service post-war was starting to issue permits for the development of ski areas on national forest lands. And when they did that, they inherited the responsibility for public safety on these lands. In the case of Little Cottonwood Canyon, it was the access road as well as the ski area itself.
LaChapelle is a trained physicist and an accomplished mountaineer. When he arrived in Alta in 1952 with his new wife Dolores and their son, he was already considered one of the world's most prominent snow science experts. He succeeded Monty Atwater, a tough, whiskey-drinking outdoorsman who was a World War II 10th Mountain Division veteran. Atwater had a degree from Harvard and expertise with artillery. He was so tough, he even smoked cigarettes around dynamite. Atwater expanded Sverre Engen's job, Alf's younger brother. Sverre often patrolled Alta's slopes alone, a practice unheard of today.
Well, he sort of founded the profession, you might say. You think of Sverre as probably the first snow ranger in the U.S.
With the aid of this test set, the position of each of these lattices can be determined at any time during the course of the winter.
The science of avalanche prevention and snow physics were fairly new in the late 1940s and early 50s. The work done at Alta was cutting edge, and those drawn to it were smart, brash men. In his book, The Avalanche Hunters, Atwater describes the prerequisites for a snow ranger. Ski deep powder, drink rye whiskey, never use one stick of powder where a dozen will make a louder bang.
Monty had brought a lot of empirical experience and keen perception to it. When I joined him, I brought a little more of the scientific background, both from my training in physics and the fact that I had spent a year in Switzerland working with the Swiss Avalanche Institutes. That big avalanche cycle in 1953 was my first encounter with a lot of big avalanches in Little Cottonwood Canyon. It certainly is still vivid in my mind.
Yeah, we just moved to Alta, and Randy was born in October, and in January, we were asleep, and it was 4 o'clock in the morning, dark and asleep, and things fell off the shelf, and Ed knew right away, he jumped out of bed and said, avalanche.
Avalanche hit some wires that had been stretched out to some instruments, pulled them right out of the cabin from their connections. That made a lot of noise. It was pretty impressive, all right. My first experience with being right next to a lot of big avalanches like that. My learning curve went up in a hurry at that point. It was a hotbed of avalanche activity, probably the most concentrated place in the country where you got lots of avalanches on the roads and on the ski area at the same time.
Highway 210 in Little Cottonwood Canyon climbs 3,000 vertical feet in just 8.5 miles. Avalanche scientists calculate that this stretch of road has the highest probability of avalanches anywhere in North America. Avalanches that have reached the highway have killed one person, a snowplow driver in 1950. This statistic is testimony to the diligence of today's forecasters and their predecessors. Building upon the standards established by Atwater and LaChapelle, Snowbird avalanche gunners John Collins and Josh Bennett start the hunt at dawn. Today, visibility is poor, so pre-established coordinates direct the 105-millimeter howitzer to targets across the closed highway.
The control techniques used today were a lot were ones that we developed, in many cases, at ALDA back in the 1950s and 60s. The use of ski checking or ski cutting of slopes. We did this quite regularly, and everywhere you see ski patrol people doing it today.
What happened next is that the beneficiaries of ALTA avalanche research were the skiers. It's very rare now to get skiers killed at resorts. The backcountry skiers are also beneficiaries to this. LaChapelle's little booklet, The ABCs of Avalanche Safety, brought avalanche awareness to a lot of people nationally.
Hello, this is Tom Kimbrough with the Forest Service Utah Avalanche Forecast Center. It's 7:30 on Friday morning. 12 to 16 inches of new snow fell in the Wasatch overnight. Winds dropped off about the time snowfall began, and they are now blowing only 5 to 15 miles an hour from northwest.
Utah powder, skiing's nirvana that words struggle to define and that the devoted can never seem to get enough of. It's even trademarked the greatest snow on earth. 1997 extreme skiing champion Brant and free skier Kim Reichelm indulge at Snow Basin in Alta. Bob Bethke and best friend Rasta bond in the Uinta Mountain backcountry. The graceful Alf Engen in his element before runs were groomed and before skiing powder was fashionable. Engen and instructor Junior Banus are credited with inventing the American style of powder skiing in the early 1950s. Alta's steep terrain and deep, light snow was their laboratory, where their experiments became today's powder turn. Modern equipment enhanced technique. The new, smooth, flowing style was coined the double dipsy, an improvement over the single dipsy.
Dick Durant's the one that developed single dipsy, and then Junior started teaching at Alta. He started what's called a double dipsy, which means both skis are parallel but the same motion exactly.
The film Margie of the Wasatch is a romanticized tale told by Sverry Engen of his affection for the attractive Alta guest who becomes lost in Alta's backcountry. While the story turns on Margie's predicament, Sverry uses the camera to showcase Utah's scenery and demonstrate the searcher's skiing prowess doing the single dipsy.
One of the world's greatest deep snow skiers. Notice his technique as he skis from ski to ski, releasing the powder snow weight on one foot and then on the other foot. Dipsy doodling, deep powder snow up to his knees. Margie spots him. She a happy, happy girl, realizing that she will have two skis again to get down the mountain. And that does deserve a big hug, a big kiss. And now, Sparrow's in the luck.
When Ed and Dolores LaChapelle moved to Alta in 1952, there were few skiers who could navigate the deep snow. For Dolores, those magical days skiing Alta powder would be the catalyst for her writing. Her autobiographical Deep Powder Snow, 40 Years of Ecstatic Skiing, Avalanches, and Earth Wisdom, was published in 1993.
I wrote the book about powder snow, and then I found here in Silverton and in Alta, when people, backcountry skiers, would come down and find out I was in the car, they'd stand there and talk to me about that book. And they were all very excited about it. They had words for something they didn't know. Any words for
it? Oh, the ideas of about skiing in deep powder snow and the various psychic aspects of this, as well as the physical ones, was something we just sort of grew up with as we evolved through the years we were living in Alta. We were all participants in the evolution of the techniques of deep powder skiing.
When you're skiing powder and you start down this slope, steep slope, and you make the first turn out of the fall line, you don't do anything else the rest of the run, because the snow, Alta snow, picks up the tips of the skis and gravity pulls them down, and that's deep powder snow, and that's deep ecology. The very basic principle is that humans are part of nature and they don't do it all by themselves.
Dolores lives in Silverton, Colorado, where she continues to write and conduct ecology workshops. A hip injury sustained in an Alta avalanche prevents her from skiing on a regular basis.
I started skiing in Europe, where we had to use skis to go to school. And then when I came to the United States, I started backcountry ski touring in the mid-1950s, late 1950s. And we ski toured with the Wasatch Mountain Club, which is very active at that time, still is. And very few people had gone into the backcountry before 1950s, because the equipment was so cumbersome, wouldn't allow it. Lone Peak, we explored that, did some of the first winter ascents on it. Camping overnight, that was a wonderful experience. Spending the night in the mountains in an army surplus mountain tent, waking up with 2 feet of snow on it, and the tent collapsed. These are all memories that I'll cherish forever.
Now people go up to see if they can get down a chute or jump off a cornice and get down the chute alive. And we didn't do that. We were only looking for powder snow. We didn't really care whether we went down an untracked, a never before skied chute. We were looking for powder snow. So we were approaching an entirely different way.
Whatever the popular description, extreme skiers, free skiers, or ski mountaineers, the number of those pushing their physical and technical limits is growing. Early in Andrew McLean's ski mountaineering career, he studied the daring descents of Utah skier Rick Wyatt and the Utah Department of Transportation's Guide of Avalanche Paths. A decade of pre-dawn ski tours before heading to work as an outdoor product designer are chronicled in McLean's book, The Shooting Gallery, A Guide to Steep Skiing in the Wasatch.
I feel a hard layer underneath there.
Thunderstruck, a 51-degree chute that plunges off of Cardiac Ridge, is one of McLean's and skiing partner Mark Holbrook's favorite vertical lines. The disclaimer in McLean's book states, obviously no one in their right mind should ski this stuff, and you shouldn't either. Tools that allow U.S. ski team downhiller Jonna Mendez to confidently maintain speeds of 70 miles per hour, and for McLean to edge down 50-degree slopes, or for any skier to avoid injury from falling, were originated by Utahn Earl Miller, skiing's most prolific inventor.
I was in charge of the university ski classes at BYU, and the first Saturday we had three bad fractures. I ended up bringing them to the medical center in my car, and it's the longest trip I ever made, and I immediately became interested in all types of ski safety.
Angle one, left front shear, releasing the toe of the left foot.
Miller's gifted mind spawned several ski-related patents, among them the first heel-toe step-in binding in 1952, the strapless ski pole, the prototype fat powder ski, the Miller Soft, and the first two-prong ski brake in 1963.
Another danger on the slopes is a loose ski from a broken safety strap. Miller has solved this problem with the ski stop. It does not interfere with normal skiing, but it will stop the ski instantly upon release from the skier's foot. Flailing skis still attached to the skier's foot can cause serious injury. This is an actual casualty.
Well, the unfair business side, I think, was when I developed the ski brake, and it was outlawed by the U.S. Forest Service for 10 years. And I consider this invention my most important invention, because I was actually asked to leave ski shops, and I knew at the time that that invention would be on every ski binding in the world, and it is on every ski binding in the world. I was ahead of my time.
Miller created unusual and painful publicity stunts to market his new inventions. In 1950, he offered $100 to any skier who could make their bindings improperly release. Not one check was cashed. 17 years later, Miller sold more releasable bindings than any company in the world.
And then we made the film Flying Skis, and this has been considered a classic movie on showing the actual falls on skis, mostly filmed at Alta.
The greatest sport of all, and traditionally one of the more dangerous. But now Miller Ski Company has solved that problem, bringing unprecedented safety to the slopes.
I went from area to area actually doing high-speed falls. And this convinced a lot of people because it showed how the binding would work in all conditions. This is the U.S. National Falling Contest, March 27th, 1966 at Alta. It was intentional falling contest, mostly on the mine dump. It drew international attention because this is the first time in the history of skiing intentional falls into specified falling traps and then optional falls had ever been done.
This contest proves that 10 angle release bindings adjusted precisely to the skier provide ultimate safety under the most dangerous circumstances. Earl Miller demonstrates the dangerous oblique somersault. This fall is into a solid ice wall at 25 miles per hour. The ski stops in less than 1 inch.
Today, Miller divides his time between his Orem, Utah shop and in courtrooms, testifying as a ski safety expert. Miller took some of the fear out of ski injuries, designing many of the intricate parts that allow modern skiers precise control. His early understanding of the relationships between pressures, angles, release complexities, bone strength, and momentum calculations made the sport safer.
Most inventors are quixotic. They do not have a good solid knowledge or acumen for the market. And so we get into this thing of inventions come out early and then they expire and then the product becomes very popular on the world market. I've had other inventions that I've made more money on, but as far as royalty on the ski brake, it was very small.
Miller's latest invention is the releasable snowboard binding that he claims prevents upper body injuries and suffocation deaths. Like his releasable ski binding and brake, the snowboard binding's success will depend on convincing skeptical riders and an industry shy of regulation.
Rick, let's see if the scent go away from you. Stand by five. Rick, let's see if the scent go away from you. Stand by five.
Utah has a rich history of nurturing competitive racers and staging elite alpine and freestyle events. Competition is in our blood. Jack Reddish, Dick Movitz, the Engans, Suzy Harris Rytting, Dev Jennings, Daryl Robison, and NCAA All-American and budding actor Jim Gaddis are names etched on hundreds of trophies.
The ski racks are carefully loaded by Jim Gaddis. With 6-foot 2-inch frame towers over the car. Jim Gaddis is handsome, alert, and well tanned. And we must say he's a better skier than a ham for our photographer.
1972 was the first year Salt Lake City was the United States candidate for the Winter Olympics. In a letter to the International Olympic Committee, President Lyndon B. Johnson wrote, "It is with great pride that I invite you to accept the use of these splendid facilities and the hospitality of the people of my country." Compared to Utah's polished bid for 2002, organizers for the 72 Games revealed their innocence when they listed the National Horseshoe Pitching Tournament alongside skiing events as proof that the state could handle Olympic complexities. That year, the Games went to Sapporo, Japan. Organized efforts to attract the Games to Utah date back to 1962. On June 16, 1995, after three decades of bidding, Salt Lake City was chosen by the widest margin ever to host the first Winter Olympic Games of the 21st century.
To the city of Salt Lake City.
A sales tax referendum raised $59 million to build the Utah Winter Sports Park, a significant piece of infrastructure that helped to seal the victory. Utah is a well-seasoned candidate. Since 1985, North America's World Cup opener has been held at the Park City Mountain Resort. And the U.S. ski team has called the town home since 1974. Snow Basin held its first downhill competition in 1940. Its 2002 Olympic course, created by the International Ski Federation's lead designer, Bernhard Russi, is considered one of the world's finest. Racers will reach speeds up to 85 miles per hour and descend the equivalent of 290 stories in 2 minutes.
I think it's wonderful for Utah. I think it is incredible publicity that is created around having the Olympic Games in 2002 for us. Whether we want it or not, and whether we're going to be happy about it afterwards, that time has to show.
We're very confident that the Games will go forward as originally planned. We're very confident.
Like a sudden winter storm, controversy blindsided the Salt Lake Organizing Committee and the entire Olympic movement.
You know, ethical lapses are not new to the Olympics movement. As early as the late 1960s, when they were bidding for the 72 Olympics that eventually went to Sapporo, there were exaggerations made about Utah facilities.
The stakes are high for an Olympic host city. International exposure and prestige created a bid process ripe for problems. The hard lessons learned from Salt Lake's actions will undoubtedly change how the International Olympic Committee makes future decisions. Under the veneer of nationalism and the business of the Games lies the true Olympic spirit: peak athletic competition and camaraderie on a world stage. Looking back half a century, one Utah racer captured that. Suzy Harris Rytting was a member of the United States Olympic team in 1948 and 1952. Now in her 70s, she blazes down runs as if racing to trim a tenth of a second off an Olympic time. Rytting is one of Utah's best known and gifted racers, whose illustrious career captured international headlines like no other.
In 1942, my parents sent me up a lift or a tow in Parley's Canyon, and to see if I liked it. I hated it anyway. They still said they wanted to ski, so we really took it up the next year in 1943, and I was trying out for the 48 Olympics in 1947.
The precocious 18-year-old dominated local and regional tournaments, eventually earning a spot as a second alternate on the 1948 team. She was considered one of the top racers in the world, a likely Olympic medalist at St. Moritz, Switzerland.
And I will never forget it. They called off the names one by one, and I was so sure that I had to be on the team from the racing results that I'd had. It was a feeling not as much of anger as of disbelief and great, just sorrow deep inside me, because I knew I should go.
Because the second alternate was not taken, Rytting did not compete in 1948. She became more determined than ever before, setting a number of records and winning every race she entered that season. Her national giant slalom title on Alta's Wildcat Run sealed her spot on the 1952 Olympic team.
We were in Switzerland, and I had come down with a terrible cold in New York, and terrible chest cold and everything, and just didn't seem to want to go away. It was suggested that I probably ought to go see a Swiss doctor, and I did, and he said, well, because of your, I told him my history and everything, and how long I'd been married and so on and so forth, and he said, well, because you're a married woman, you've been married for 2 years, it's very possible that you're pregnant. And this was as far as it went. But the Olympic team officials were very unhappy, and they felt that surely I must have known and that I must be 3 to 4 months pregnant instead of just barely. And they decided that I had to go home immediately.
Because it was too early, her pregnancy couldn't be medically proven. However, U.S. Olympic officials still worried about the negative publicity of having a pregnant woman on the team. Her Olympic emblems were stripped off her coat, and one of America's most promising woman racers was again denied a chance to compete.
Something like this would not happen today. It could have been handled much more easily if they had simply said, we have a married woman on our team and she's found out that she's going to have a baby and she's going to retire from the team. It could have been very simple, but instead it was made a humiliating, very sad affair for a long, long time.
On September 7th, 1952, the controversial new addition to the Rytting family was born, Jessica, nicknamed Jinx.
But then in later years, it has become more of an interest, especially because of women's issues. The fact that young women that I talk to now are absolutely incredulous. They can't believe that I could have been treated that way or would have been handled that way. That is, I think, the feeling now, too, that it never should have happened, and it won't again, that type of thing.
The favorite occupation while waiting out a storm was playing hearts. Atwater was a killer hearts player. We would all get into these deep games, which would interrupt occasionally to go out and make a snow observation.
All we wanted to do was ski powder. So we knew that nobody else was going on the slope, so we could go and count on in late afternoon that slope would still be unskied. That's what was good about it.
We need to get away from skiing as an industry and start bringing it back to what the roots of skiing was, which is really recreation on a fairly smaller scale. I think the philosophy of the mom-and-pop operations wasn't all that bad.
I think the rewarding factor is being able to go to various ski shops in the world and see your products, and it gives you an inner feeling that's indescribable, really. And something inside you that means you contributed something to the whole sport and the whole world.
I want to feel like that I've given what I had in the way of material means and energy and you might say basic values and attitude about life to making a place where people can come and re-strengthen themselves, as I said earlier, broaden their horizon, deepen their perspective.
I can't imagine what my life would have been had it not been for ski racing, or what direction the people I've met, the places I've been, the memories I have. It almost leads me to tears. It has been so wonderful.
Time moves. History is made and remade. Much has changed and will continue to change with the way we ski. But the snow, the mountains, and the adventurous skiing spirit will remain the same. With the Wasatch Front becoming a center for winter sports competition in North America, the well of human experience will remain full with new stories to tell.
This program was made possible by a grant from the George S. and Dolores Dore Eccles Foundation, the Utah Humanities Council, the Park City Arts Council, and these other contributors.